Hello, my dear friends. Today I am going to discuss concurrency control part 2. In previous video, I have already discussed concurrency control part 1, where I have discussed block-based protocols, growing phase, shrinking phase, deadlock definitions. In this video, I have discussed deadlock handling, deadlock preventions, deadlock detections, deadlock recovery, and timestamp based protocols. Before going to next slide, I have request, kindly subscribe this video. Now I describe what is deadlock handling. A system is in deadlock if there is a set of transactions such that every transaction in the set is waiting for another transaction in the set. In previous video, I have discussed, suppose there are two transactions TI and TJ. One transaction access the data item in exclusive mode and another transaction access the same data item in shared mode. Then there is a situation that two transactions never continue its normal execution. Such situation is called deadlock. So after occurring deadlock, we can prevent or avoid the deadlock. So deadlock prevention protocol ensures that the system will never enter into a deadlock state. Some prevention strategies are required that each transaction logs all the data items before it begins executions. That is, when a data item wants to access that data item, it first requests the concurrency control manager. Then it holds the logs. After it holds the logs, it can access. And when it completes the executions, it unlocks the data item, that is, release the data item. Second conditions, impose partial ordering of all data items and require that a transaction can log data items only in the order specified by the partial order. Now I describe deadlock preventions. There are two methods to describe the deadlock prevention. One is wait die scheme, that is non-preemptive, and second is wound wait scheme, that is preemptive. We know that difference between non-preemptive and preemptive. In non-preemptive mode, when a transaction acquires log, it may not release log until it finishes. But in preemptive mode, when a transaction acquires log, it should forcefully release the log by the concurrency control manager. So first of all, I discuss wait die scheme, non-preemptive. Older transaction may wait for younger one. Here older transaction means the transactions which is arriving first, and younger means the transactions which is recently arriving. So older transactions may wait for the younger one to release data item. Older means here smallest timestamp. Younger transactions never wait for older ones. They are rolled back instead. So older means the transactions whose have smaller counters, and younger transaction means whose have larger counters. Second, a transaction may die several times before acquiring the needed data item. This is the wait die scheme. Second is wounded wait scheme, preemptive. Older transaction wounded or forcefully rolled back of younger transactions instead of waiting for it. Younger transactions may wait for older ones. Maybe fewer rollback than wait die scheme. In wounded wait scheme, have a fewer rollback than wait die scheme. Then I discuss next part of deadlock prevention. Both in wait and die and in wound wait scheme, a rollback transaction is restarted with its original timestamp. So when a transaction enter in a deadlock state, then it can be restarted from the original positions. Older transactions thus have precedence over newer ones, and the starvation hence avoided. That is, the older transaction forget the preference first to the newer transactions. For these reasons, starvations are never happening. Then I describe timestamp based scheme. A transactions wait for a lock only for a specified amount of time. If the lock has not been granted within that time, the transaction is rolled back and restarted. That is, a transaction request for a lock to the concurrency control manager, but after the fixed amount of time, when it cannot get permissions, it restarted from the first positions. Thus, a deadlock are not possible. Simple to implement, but starvation is possible. Also, difficult to determine good value of the timeout interval. Then I described deadlock detections. Actually, deadlock can be detected by the graph theory. Suppose there are two transactions, Ti and Tj. Deadlock can be described as a wait for graph which consists of a pair G equal to VE. Here V is the vertex and E is the edge. Vertex V implemented by the transactions and edge defined by the waiting state and hold state. Here V is the set of vertices, that is the all of the transactions of the system. E is the set of edges. Each element is an ordered pair Ti to Tj. Here Tj accesses the data item and Ti requests the data item. Show and arc are designed from Ti to Tj. If Ti to Tj is an edge E, then there is a directed edge from Ti to Tj, implying that Ti is waiting for Tj to release a data item. That is, Tj accessing the data item and Ti is waiting for that data item, and Ti access that data item when Tj finished his execution and released the lock. When Ti requests a data item currently being held by Tj, then the edge Ti to Tj is inserted in the wait for graph. When transition Ti requests a data item and that data item accessed by transition Tj, then an edge are inserted from Ti to Tj. This edge is removed only when Tj is no longer holding a data item needed by Tj. That is, the edge from Ti to Tj is removed when Tj has finished his executions and unlocked the data item and Ti acquired that data item. The system is in deadlock state if and only if the wait for graph has a cycle. That is, here, cycle is the necessary step for occurring of the deadlock. If there is a no cycle, that is, deadlock has not happened, must involve a deadlock detection algorithm periodically to look for cycles. Here is a two examples. Two examples describe that there are two cycles, that is T18, T17, T19. There is no cycles, but here is a transaction. T19, T18, T20, there is a cycle and edge replies that a cycle has happened. So it is the deadlock state, but in this state, deadlock has not happened since there is no cycle. Edge defined that there is no cycle. After the deadlock is occurred, it can be recovered. So I describe deadlock recovered. When deadlock is detected, some transaction will have to roll back, made a victim to break deadlock. Select that transaction as victim that will incur minimum cost. That is, there are multiple transactions for which deadlock has happened, but we select the transactions that have the minimum loss of items or minimum cost. Rollback. Determine how far to roll back transactions. Total rollback, that is, about the transaction restarted, and more effective to roll back transactions only as far as necessary to break the deadlock. That is, there is a step where a transaction roll back from starting positions or from a positions where it is stable state. If it is rollback from starting position, that is called total rollback, or if it is starting from a state where it is stable, that is called partial rollback. Starvation happens if some transactions is always choose as a victim. Include the number of rollback in the cost factor to avoid starvations. Now we describe timestamp based protocols. Each transaction issue a timestamp when it entered the system. That is, when a transaction entered the system, a counter has been started. That counter is called as a timestamp. If an older transaction TI has timestamp TSTI and a new transaction TJ has assigned a timestamp TJ, that is, TI is appeared first, so it has been executed have a longer time and the counter is bigger than TJ since it is appears last. So we write TSTI less than TSTJ. The protocol manager concurrent execution such that the timestamp determines the serializability order. In order to assure that behavior, the protocol maintains for each data item queue two timestamp value. There are two timestamp value. One is W timestamp queue and second is R timestamp queue. W timestamp queue is the largest timestamp of the transaction that execute the write queue operation successfully. And R timestamp queue is the largest timestamp of the transactions that execute the read queue operation successfully. Next, the timestamp ordering protocol ensures that any conflicting read and write operations are executed in timestamp order. That is, suppose a transaction TI issue a read queue data items, then it first conditions if TSTI less than equal to W timestamp queue, then TI needs to write the data item queue that was already overwritten. Hence, the read operation is rejected and TI is rolled back. Since TSTI less than equal to W timestamp queue, here data item cannot be read. So if it is written, then read operation is rejected. If TSTI greater than equal to W timestamp queue, then the read operation is executed and R timestamp queue is set to maximum. Second, suppose that transaction TI issue write queue operations. If TSTI less than equal to R timestamp queue, then the value of queue that TI is producing was needed previously. The system assumed that the value would never be produced. In this case, write operation is rejected when TSTI less than R timestamp queue. Hence, the write operation is rejected and TI is rolled back. If TSTI less than W timestamp queue, then TI is attempting to write an obsolete value of queue. Since the value is obsolete, that is already needed but now is not required, so write operation is rejected. Hence, the write operation is rejected and TI is rolled back. Otherwise, the write operation is executed and W timestamp queue is set to TSTI. Thank you very much. If you like my video, then share and subscribe. Thank you very much for waiting for next video.